Father in heaven, we love you today. And we thank you for your spirit in this place. God, we've showed up at this place today. We've prayed prayers in your name. We've sang songs in your name. We've given tithe and offering in your name. We've celebrated the sacraments in your name. But now, God, we need to hear from your word. So I pray that as I stand behind this sacred desk, God, that you would take me out of self, wrap me up, tie me up, entangle me up in your spirit, that what I should say will be pleasing in your sight. Pray that your word today would uplift. I pray that your word would strengthen. I pray that your word would encourage some soul. Now, God, allow the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart to be acceptable in your sight, Lord. For you are my Christ, my Redeemer, my Lord, and my Savior. But most of all, God, I found you to be my very best friend. And all of God's people said, amen, 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 and praise the Lord. 2 Thessalonians chapter number 3. 2 Thessalonians chapter number 3. Starting at verse number 1, reading from the New King James Version of the Bible, there you will find these words recorded. Finally, brethren, pray for us that the word of the Lord may run swiftly and be glorified just as it is with you, and that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men, for not all have faith. But the Lord is faithful, who will establish you and guard you from the evil one. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of our God. From that third verse, Paul said, but the Lord is faithful, who will establish you, guard you from the evil one. But the Lord is faithful, who will establish you, guard you from the evil one. I want to talk this morning from the thought, faithful is our God. Faithful is our God. That word faithful kept bothering me, Dr. Mitchell. And so upon my study, made my way to the concordance to really understand what faithful meant in this Greek text. The word faithful in the Greek is a word called pistos, P-I-S-T-O-S. And it's an adjective meaning to be trustworthy, faithful, or believing. And so that text, that third verse could literally read, but the Lord is pistos. The Lord is trustworthy. The Lord is believing, who will establish you, guard you from the evil one. Brothers and sisters, from last November to present time, our United States has been on a downward spiral. From the leadership of our government to our political officials to our local and even in our individual churches, it seems that trouble has came and made itself comfortable in our lives. Because trouble has came and made itself comfortable in our lives, those of us who have been on this battlefield for the Lord for any length of time seemingly have been wavering in our faith toward the Lord. No matter what the situation is or has been or even will be, God never stops being faithful. I've said it before and I'll continue to say it. Jesus said in John 16 and 33, in this world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I've already overcome the world. And so if we just use the method of deduction, while I deduce that we really have no need to get unnerved at the trouble of the world, because Jesus said trouble was coming. I don't know why it is that we get surprised when you go to the doctor and there's some sickness in your body. The Bible says that trouble will come. I don't know why it is that we get surprised when loved ones have to die, because Jesus said that we didn't come here to stay, but we're only sojourners passing through. It confuses me from a spiritual perspective. I understand why we react that way from a carnal perspective, Pastor Shackelford, but from a spiritual perspective, it confuses me why the child of God gets so unnerved at the troubles and issues of the world. The Bible has let us know that we're going to go through some stuff, but as Paul declared in this second letter to the church of Thessalonica, he declared, "But the Lord is faithful." I want you to understand the power of that conjunction in the beginning of verse number 3. When you read the text, he says, "Finally, brethren, pray for us." Paul is speaking to the church. He's telling the church to pray for us, that the word of the Lord might run swiftly and be glorified, just as it is with you. He says, "And that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men, for not all have faith." Wait a minute, Paul, you just confused me. You need to tell me that there are people in the church who really don't have faith. You need to tell me that there are some people who just took communion and they don't have faith. You need to tell me that there are some people who have been on the battlefield for over half their life, but they still lack faith. Paul said, "That's what I'm telling you." He said, "That's why I wrote it. And that we would be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men, for not all have faith." Wait a minute, you mean to tell me that there are people who come to the house of the Lord and are unreasonable? You mean to tell me that people get up on Sunday morning, get dressed, put their Sunday best on, get in their nice fine car, make their way down Highway 81 South and sit in the house of the Lord, and there are unreasonable people? You mean to tell me that there are wicked people in the church? Well, wait a minute, I thought the church was a place that housed saved people. I thought the church was a place that housed people who love the Lord. Paul is saying just the opposite. Everybody that's in the church does not have the church in them. And so therefore I'm writing this letter to encourage the church, that those of us who do have the church in us, we've got to be careful that we allow the Lord to deliver us from people who are unreasonable, people who are wicked, because they don't have faith. But then Paul says, but the Lord is faithful in spite of the unreasonable, in spite of the wicked, in spite of those who don't have faith. The Lord is faithful. This letter from the pen of Paul, written to the church, this church was experiencing spiritual growth. Chapter 1, verse 3. They are a loving church that's active, growing, and reaching out. However, the church is also in trouble. The Thessalonians were suffering under the persecution from without and from within. The pagans around them wanted to see the church destroyed. The Bible says in chapter 1, verse number 5, he says, "Which is manifest evidence that the righteous judgment of God, that you may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you also suffer." Verse number 6 says, "Since it is a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulations those who trouble you." Can I encourage somebody and let you know you ain't got to be worried about people that try to trouble you, because the Bible says he will repay them. See, you got to stop trying to get even with people and let God fight your battle. Did you not hear what David said, that he will make a table before you in the presence of your enemies? You got to learn that it's not your job to try to pay people back. It's your job to keep doing what God has commanded and commissioned you to do, and let God handle them. Vengeance is mine, said the Lord. The pagans wanted to see the church destroyed. The unruly members of the church who had embraced false doctrines
life. They were trying to fundamentally alter the course of the church. Wait a minute, Paul, you mean to tell me that even in 2017 that there are still people in the church who are members of the church who are trying to fundamentally alter the move of God? There are people in the church who are officers in the church who don't want to see the church move forward. They want to see the church stay where it is. I'll go in reverse. Those are the kind of people who have a past tense theology. I just made that up. It's a past tense theology because they operate in the past. Well, Pastor, I remember when we used to so and so. And I remember when the choir used to so and so. And I remember when they used to do this. That was good for that time. But we're no longer living in that time. Time has moved on. And we got to move with the time. We've got too many people in the house of God who are trying to alter the course of the church. Paul writes to this church to encourage and to preserve in the face of trial. He writes to Thessalonica to address their concerns about the second coming of Jesus. And just in case you have forgotten, the Lord, he is coming back. I can't tell you when. I can tell you he's on his way. You see, false teachers had convinced many that the day of the Lord had already come, and they had missed the rapture of the church spoken in Paul's first letter at Corinth. So that's why he writes to challenge the church to deal with those in their number who refuse to walk by the Lord's commands. And so you need to understand, Mount Moriah, that no matter how hard I preach, and no matter how hard we pray, no matter how much we jump and shout, there are still going to be some people who refuse to walk by the command of God. That's why the Bible says that we need to pray that we be delivered from the unreasonable and from the wicked. We still got to worship with them. We still got to work with them. But God, deliver me from people who do not want to walk according to your commandment. Deliver me from people who always want to try to keep a mess and strife. Deliver me from people who always try to find out, who always have an ulterior motive. God, strengthen my discernment so when I see them coming, I can quickly stay away from them. I got to deal with you. But my grandmama said, some people, you got to feed them. We all have a story. Because I done been through hell and I walk. And you don't know what I done been through. And I'd be dang old if I'm going to let you bring me back into what God has already delivered me from. I done fasted too long. I done prayed too long. Because you're carnal and not spiritual. It's in the Bible. The carnal man cannot understand the spiritual things of God. It sounds like rubbish to him because his mind is so wrapped up, tied up in carnal stuff that the things of God don't make sense to him. That's why those who are carnal can never adopt the things of the Spirit. So this church is a church in trouble, Dr. Mitchell. But the Thessalonians were suffering under persecution. They were a church in trouble. They were suffering under persecution on the inside. And on the outside, the pagans around them wanted to see the church destroyed. And so Paul begins to write this letter to encourage them to persevere during the trial of what they're going through. This is a church that is in crisis, and true believers in Thessalonica needed a strong word of encouragement. And just like they need a word in Thessalonica, we need castle in the text that form our text today. The very word they needed is given to them. In verse number 3, Paul says, but the Lord is faithful. In spite of what has already happened, the Lord is faithful. In spite of what's going on right now, the Lord is faithful. In spite of what's going to happen tomorrow, the Lord is faithful. In spite of what people are trying to do, the Lord is faithful. The Lord is trustworthy. That's what the people needed to hear. And that's what we need to hear today. I don't know how you feel about it, but I need to be reminded every now and then that my God is still a faithful God. I need to be encouraged every now and then, because everything that I see in the world, even though I'm spiritual, because there's two sides to me. There's a spiritual side and there's a carnal side. Every now and then my flesh rises up and my flesh begins to wonder, Lord, where art thou? Lord, do you see what's going on? Lord, do you hear what's going on? Lord, don't you know that we got a fool in the White House? But I gotta be reminded that's in my flesh, but in my spirit, my spirit reminds me that the government shall be upon his shoulders. So Gray, don't you worry about the fool in the White House. You just keep your mind stayed on me, and I'll take care of the White House, because in spite of how it looks, I'm still faithful. I'm still faithful in spite of what's going on. In spite of how it looks, I'm still faithful. So Paul says, if you really gonna tell the people about God being faithful, you really gotta deal with the faithfulness of and the deity of God. So the first thing you need to understand about our God being faithful is, number one, he's faithful in his person. Yeah, the Bible says in verse 3, but the Lord is faithful. The implication is the faithfulness, is that faithfulness is synonymous with the character of God himself. All right. The Bible is full of insight into the character and into the person of God. Yes, let's just talk about and look at how the person of God is faithful. Come here, Moses. I figured they wouldn't believe me. Come here, Moses. Help me understand. Moses said in Deuteronomy chapter 4, for the Lord thy God is a consuming fire and even a jealous God. For the Lord thy God is a merciful God. For the Lord thy God is a jealous God among you. For the Lord thy God is a God of gods, a Lord of lords, a great God, a mighty and terrible, which regardeth not persons, nor taketh reward. He said in Deuteronomy chapter 33, the eternal God is thy refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. In Joshua chapter 1, the Bible says, for the Lord thy God is with thee, wheresoever thou goest. In 2 Chronicles chapter 30, the Bible says, for the Lord your God is gracious and merciful, and will not turn away his face from you, if you would return unto him. Yes, Job 36 and 5, the Bible says, behold, God is mighty, and despiseth not any. He is mighty in strength and wisdom. Come to David, Psalms number 7. God judges the righteous, and God is angry with the wicked every day. Psalms 46, I'm just talking about the faithfulness and the personality of God. Psalms 46 says, God is my refuge and my strength, a very present help in the time of trouble. Psalms 47 says, for God is the king of all the earth. Yes, Psalms 54 says, behold, God is my helper. Yes, Psalms 68 says, that he is our God. He is the God of salvation. Unto God the Lord belongeth issues from death. Psalms 75 says, but God is the judge, and he puts down one and set him up another. Psalms 99 says, for the Lord our God is holy. Psalms 116 says, gracious is the Lord and righteous. Yes, our God is merciful. Jesus said in John chapter 3 that he had received the testimony that he is still the God is true. John chapter 4 said that God is spirit, and they that worship him must must worship in spirit and in truth. I just came to let you know that even in his person, God is still faithful. Paul say, John, 1 John chapter 1 said, then this is the message that we have heard from him, and declare unto you that God is light, and in him there is no darkness. John 1 John chapter 4 says, he that knoweth not knoweth not God, for my God is love. Nahum chapter 1 verse 7, the Bible says that the Lord is good and stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knoweth him that trust in him. You need to understand that no matter what happens in the world, I heard David say that the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, and the world and they that dwell therein. The same God today is the same God who was here yesterday, and he'll be the same God who's here tomorrow. You just need to testify that faithful is our God. You need to understand that the word faithful in the New Testament, it means that God is trustworthy in transacting his business. He can execute his commands. He can discharge whatever duties he wants to. It speaks of one who keeps all his promises. In the Old Testament, it speaks of firmness and steadfastness. Is there anybody here who can be a testimony this morning that over the course of my life, I've been fake and fickle, but the Lord has always been faithful? No matter where I've been, and no matter where I am right now, I'm so glad that my God is still faithful, because faithfulness identifies the very person of God. Come in John, in Revelations 3 and 14, he reminded me that he is firm and faithful. He says, let it be, and it is. He is the God who never changes. He is the God who never fails. He has always been. He will always be. Great I am. He is the God who can be counted on. Just as he's always, always been. He's always faithful. That's who he is. Faithful is my God. He's faithful in his person. His person. But not only is he faithful in his person, he's faithful in his promise. And still in verse number 3, he says, but the Lord is faithful. So since God is faithful, he can be counted to stand by his word. Paul reminds the people of Thessalonica that God will establish you and keep you from evil. In the King James Version, that word establish carries the idea of making something firm and stable. It means that God will strengthen those and cause us to become constant in our lives and confirm in our mind. That word keep means to guard. It carries the idea of being protected. It is God's promise that he will protect us from every enemy, whether they're inside or outside the church. Because my God is faithful, he can be trusted to do exactly what he's saying. That's the biblical testimony of the faithfulness of God.
baptized.
You have planted your seeds. You have watered your crop. But now it's harvest time. You've been planting your seeds of prayer. You've been planting your seeds of intercession. You've been planting your seeds of fasting. But now it's harvest time. It's time to reap the seeds that you sow. It's time to receive what you've been praying for. It's time to receive what you've been laying on your face about. It's harvest time. And we, God, a faithful God, who will make sure that we receive everything he has in store for me. Don't you worry about the wicked, because they don't have faith anyway. And the Bible says, and I'm paraphrasing, but the Bible says, if a man be foolish, let him be foolish. Because Paul said, for not all have faith.
All right, amen.
And if you keep reading, I stopped at verse 3, but I'm finished. But if you keep reading that text, he says, and we have confidence in the Lord concerning you, both you and do the will, do all the things we command. He says, now may the Lord direct your heart into the love of God and into the patience of Christ. Don't you worry about people who want to be unreasonable. How is it that you can be so calm about stuff now?
Come on.
Greg, I know you. I remember when you was quick to say some Sunday school words. That's why I told y'all in Bible study a couple weeks ago I have multiple personalities. My name is Charvis Kiwan. And everybody calls me Juan for short.
All right.
My family and close friends. But my government name is Charvis.
All right.
See, Mount Moriah, y'all hired Charvis. Because Charvis is safe.
So
Charles says, He's been faithful. Even when I wasn't faithful, God was still faithful. So, I intentionally, I don't watch the news, David Thompson, because it's quite depressing. And I get aggravated in my flesh when I see number 45 making such a donkey of himself. And so I just keep praying for the healing of the nation. Maybe I'm just silly for thinking this way, but the same God that brought me to the trouble, He'll take me through. And even if He decides not to take me through, I remember what the three Hebrew boys said. Our God will save us. But if He don't, it's still all right. I'm really not concerned about what the world does to me anymore. Because the world does exactly what it's supposed to do. And I'm just a visitor in this world. This world is not my home. Don't misunderstand me. I want to stay here as long as I can, but whenever He get ready, it doesn't matter because I'm leaving anyway. And so while I'm here, why am I going to concern myself with the unrighteous and the wicked who don't have faith? Keep concerning yourself with foolish people. I wish y'all could hear me this morning. You give way to the enemy when you concern yourself with foolish people. I'm finished, but y'all know I like TV. And so the other day, I was watching In the Heat of the Night, one of my favorite movies. And Parker came in to give Chief Gillespie some community gossip. Standing right there, Chief Gillespie said, he listened to what Parker had to say. Then he said, Parker, now what do you want me to do with what you just gave me? What do you want me to do with this? You gave me this information. It's of no value. It's you telling me what somebody told you. It has no weight. So where's the trash can? I'm just going. That's how you have to treat unreasonable people. Because if you're not careful, you'll allow the unreasonable to blind you from seeing the faithfulness of God. Now you can't get away from them because they're everywhere. Outside and inside. But those of us who know who he is, we got to be steadfast. And understand that God is faithful in his person, in his promise, and in his performance. That if God said he was going to bring you out, that's what he's going to do. He didn't say when he was going to bring you out. He just said he would bring you out. And so what do I do while I'm waiting for him to bring me out? Come here, David. Come here, Isaiah. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings of eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. I don't know who your God is, but faithful is my God. Those of the church are opening.